Hello and welcome to the latest edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. My name's Andrew Bonnington. I'm Editorial Director for European and African Oil based out of our London office. I'm here today to talk with a couple of colleagues of mine about some very interesting trends on a very interesting continent, Africa, which as a result of the lower oil price environment that we find ourselves in, is facing some new challenges and also some new opportunities. Here I am today talking with two of my colleagues, Eklavya Gupte, who's senior editor for Africa Oil News, and our resident gasoline expert here, Francesco Di Salvo, who has been looking at the gasoline market for 2 years now, and in a very interesting market as far as Africa is concerned, being such a big importer of refined products. Firstly, Eklavya, so what's happening in the crude oil market in Africa right now, and how's it reacting to this low price environment that we find ourselves in?
Yes, you know, Africa, as such a big exporter and producer of crude oil, has gone through some major changes in the last few years. Obviously, in the last year, you've seen the big price fall for crude oil. But some of these changes were impacting the African markets a long, long time ago. Mm-hmm. The case being, if you look at the West African crude market, for example, they have borne the main brunt of the rising US shale oil production over the last 4 years. So if you look at the Nigerian crude market, for example, now Nigeria is Africa's largest oil producer, and it produces more than 2 million barrels per day. Out of that 2 million barrels per day, until about 7 years ago, 1 million barrels per day of Nigerian crude would go to the US. And the US liked Nigerian crude oil because it was light and sweet and very rich in gasoline. But ever since the US found a lot of shale oil product, they've no longer needed to import that much light sweet crude because US shale oil is very similar in quality to Nigerian crude. As a result, you've seen this big change where a lot of the Nigerian crude, even Angolan crude for that matter, which is a bit more heavy, but it is also sweet, as in low in sulfur, has had to find new homes. And this has had a big impact.
So what does that mean for the differentials and the pricing of Nigerian crude in particular?
Yes, so what we've seen with the flat price of oil falling, so have the differentials fallen. And if you look, you know, at Bonny Light, which is one of the main Nigerian flagship grades, differentials there have fallen tremendously over the last few years. In fact, the Bonny Light official selling price by the Nigerian oil ministry was a 10-year low a month ago. So things are really weak. Even Kwa Iboe, which is actually the most liquid grade and the most popular grade in Nigeria, especially in countries like India and regions like Europe, differentials have fallen to close to 7 to 10 year lows in some cases. So they've had this was expected, but with the flat price falling, with the new changes, and with the oversupply in the market currently, especially with the light sweet crude, we've seen a big, we've seen a lot of downward pressure for West African crude.
Okay, interesting. We'll probably come back to that and elaborate on that a bit later. But sure. Francesco, on gasoline and refined products, what's the state of play there now? Obviously, you know, Nigeria, such a big market for European refiners. How are things looking there right now?
Definitely, it's a very interesting time, really, for West Africa as a region in terms of their gasoline imports. We all know that the supply-demand balance has often been negative, therefore always pointing to a deficit. And this has proven to be one of the main opportunities, really, for the net long European market to be able to send some of their excess arbitrage barrels to West Africa, a region that has been absorbing a lot of this length. We're counting about 1.4 million metric tons per month actually heading to West Africa, which is quite a substantial volume. And of these, about 1 million actually heading into Nigeria, the region's largest consumer, which imports about 80% of its gasoline at the moment.
Okay, interesting. Back to you, Eklavya. That challenge for Nigeria in particular and West Africa more generally, what does that mean for those countries in terms of finding new markets now the US is no longer the market it was?
Yes, so that's been the main challenge, is to find big customers, because now less than almost 3% of Nigerian crude exports every year goes to the US. So some of the interesting developments we've seen, I would say, firstly, is that India is the largest buyer of Nigerian crude, if you're looking specific country-wise. And India, with a sort of growing population, a growing economy, needs to consume and needs to produce and consume more diesel and gasoline. Mm. And the local domestic crudes in India are also very similar to Nigerian crudes. So Indian demand for Nigerian crudes has been very strong. About 17% of Nigerian crude every month goes to India. However, in the last 3 months, we've seen them buy as much as 25%. Because right now prices are low, as mentioned in the previously, even the differentials for those specific crudes are very low. And secondly, refining margins are quite strong. So there's a lot more demand from India recently. We also see Europe. Europe now is the biggest sort of demand center from a regional, from a region point of view for Nigeria. It's almost 45 to 46%. Of Nigerian crude finds home in the European refiners. And this, interestingly, has sort of coincided with falling North Sea production and also with the decline of Libyan exports. So Europe used to rely a lot on light sweet Libyan crude, but ever since the unrest, which unfortunately continues today, and a lot of uncertainty surrounding the crude exports from the North African country, Europe is now pulling in more barrels from Nigeria and from the other West African countries. Interestingly, you also have Angola. Now, Angola has, Angolan crude, as I said, is heavy and sweet, but it's very, very popular in Asia. Almost 70 to 80% of Angolan crude goes to Asia every month, and 50% of that goes to China. And China, you know, is the second largest crude oil consumer in the world, and they are really, the refineries there, like, they have a big appetite for Angolan crudes, and there's always that demand. So they've had to find new buyers, but we've seen some new flows emerged, which I will quickly touch upon. One is we've seen Venezuela suddenly, in the last, say, 2 months or so, been suddenly buying a little bit of Nigerian crude, and this is very rare, because I was looking at some of the statistics. And from 2002 to 2011, no Nigerian crude ever went to Venezuela. And you've seen pockets go, but over the last 2 months, a lot of the Venezuelan refineries are trying to blend Nigerian light sweet crude with crude from the Orinoco Belt, which is very heavy. And there's some, you know, there's some talk that they're trying to blend those crudes together to make a standalone crude product and possibly attractive to the U.S. refiners. And the reason for this is because the U.S. themselves are, even though they're importing, as said, they're importing very little light sweet crude because they have their own shale, but they're importing a lot of heavy crude and blending it. So Venezuela is trying to buy Nigerian crude and do a similar thing to make them more attractive to the US refiners.
Interesting, okay. Back to you, Francesco, just to give it a bit more of a global context, if you like, when it comes to gasoline. You know, we've seen a lot of reports and written a lot ourselves on this as a company about the real extreme strength in gasoline right now, which is very much reversing a trend of maybe the last 3 to 4 years. What's happening there? What's going on there right now?
Absolutely. 2015 is definitely proving as a game-changing year for the gasoline market, especially from Northwest Europe. We've seen the gasoline margins actually break the $30 per barrel mark on the European Northwest European gasoline barges. So definitely a game-changing year, also surprisingly driven by demand. We have demand centers that are more price elastic, such as the US, for example, where the low flat price environment has stimulated consumption, which is driving a lot of the barrels to move from Northwest Europe into the US. But at the same time, the cheap access to crude, especially in the US Gulf Coast, has meant that the margins would be so good for refiners to actually maximize output, and which is why the US Gulf Coast is surprisingly actually coming into the in competition with Northwest Europe when supplying gasoline to West Africa.
Okay, interesting. I think, you know, one thing's interesting for us, or certainly for us to track over the next 6 months and a year, and it's a lot of the questions that we're getting right now is whether that's going to be sustained, that gasoline strength that we see right now. Changing tack finally, just Eklavya, looking at the rest of Africa, and, you know, maybe some of those more frontier producing countries. What's the status there in terms of, you know, East Africa as an example and some of the developments going on there?
Yes, definitely. You know, Africa still, there's a lot more oil to be potentially found and explored. And a lot of the companies, upstream companies right now, despite the low price environment, are still, you know, looking quite actively. In terms, as you mentioned, East Africa, I would say, is the sort of main potential in the next few years. And been looking quite closely at the Ugandan, the developments in the Ugandan oil sector. And so at the moment, there are three oil companies. You have Total, you have CNOOC, and you have Tullow Oil that are in Uganda. Mm-hmm. Only one of them actually has a production operating license. So oil was first discovered in Uganda in 2006, and now we're in 2015, and we still haven't actually found any oil. However, the first oil from Uganda is expected to be produced by 2018. Mm-hmm. It's late 2017, early 2018, to be specific. Mm-hmm. The biggest challenge for Uganda, like a lot of the African markets, has been infrastructure. And as you know, Uganda is a landlocked country. So they have something around 60,000 barrels per day at the moment could be discovered by early 2018. But their biggest challenge is, because it is landlocked, they have to find a way to, firstly, their plans to build a refinery, for example. Mm-hmm. And the refinery is going to be operated by a Russian-led consortium, which has 60% of the stake of the refinery with 40% to the Ugandan government. And there's also plans to build a pipeline from Uganda through Kenya for crude export purposes. And there's a Japanese company actually which is doing a pre-feasibility study to find out which is the best route. So we're still a few years away from actual oil being produced or exported, but it's definitely there's definitely a lot of potential here, and a lot of the oil companies are looking at it seriously. And lastly, you have the first oil licensing round in Uganda, which actually the deadline was at the end of June. Mm. So we should know in the next few months which companies will be part of this new licensing round. So yes, there's a lot to watch out for on the East African front.
Interesting. I think it touches upon an important subject for Africa, which is infrastructure, which is a lack of refining capacity, a lack of pipeline systems as well, which leads us nicely to the last point, which is back with you, Francesco. We talked earlier about Nigeria in particular and West Africa's thirst for gasoline, their huge imports into that part of the world. Are there any plans for that to change and new infrastructure in that region to provide the gasoline that those consumers need?
Oh, definitely. We're seeing a tendency in West Africa at the moment towards deregulation and liberalization of the oil products market. We've seen Angola at the beginning of the year actually move forward to remove subsidies, an example that has been followed most recently by Ghana. Now, Nigeria, as you mentioned, is the region's largest importer, currently has a very limited operating capacity in their refineries. Now, there are plans for a new refinery to be built in Lagos, which could be ready by 2017. It is being reported, for a capacity of 500,000 barrels a day. At the same time, though, we're also waiting for legislations to come in, namely the Petroleum Industry Bill, which could point to the liberalization of the downstream sector and therefore boost investment in this sector.
Great. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Very interesting. And as I said, there's a lot going on in Africa right now that's going to be very interesting for us to look at going forward. That leads us nicely into our Platts Africa Forum that we're holding on August 27th. Hopefully we'll be elaborating on some of the subjects that we touched upon here, and I look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.